Joining us in the studio this morning, it's an honor to have her here. It's her first time live on Head Start. We have Health Officer in Charge, Maria Rosario Vergere. Secretary, good morning to you, ma'am. Thank you for coming to the studio. I know your schedule is so busy. What does it mean when the World Health Organization describes COVID as, and this is the quote, still a public health emergency of international concern? The word emergency is still there.
Yes, if you remember, Karen, when they declared this public health emergency of international concern, that was the very first time that we had these cases across the globe. And before, there was a lot of unknowns. That's why they had it as an emergency. Mm-hmm. Now that they are seeing a number of or thousands of cases again of deaths across the different countries, big countries right now, so they are very much concerned. And one of the things that I think triggered them to still continue on with this public health emergency would be the lack of data currently, because a lot of countries are not reporting that their cases anymore as before, because many are using the antigen test.
Yeah, and not only that, when you travel right now all over the world, you have many people who aren't wearing masks, no requirement even for antigen tests. And if you have COVID, you feel you have a cold or a flu.
Yes, that's why the WHO is very much concerned, because people are getting complacent across the globe. And with this kind of behavior, there is an increasing number of deaths across the different countries of the world. And aside from that, there is this COVID-19 surge in China.
So locally po, dito po sa Pilipinas, do we still describe COVID-19 as a public health emergency? Sa atin po, what is the status of COVID?
Well, actually, here in the country, there are two proclamations. One proclamation would be coming from the president, the previous president, President Duterte. That was in 2020 when he adopted the public health emergency status of the WHO. Okay. And then there is this state of calamity also, which is an executive order, which has lapsed already last December 31. Mm-hmm. So currently, based on what we have right now in policy, a public health emergency is there because of this proclamation. But if we look at our situation right now, it's very manageable. And I think Filipinos have already accepted this, that the virus is here to stay. We just need to protect ourselves, and our cases are manageable at this point.
Okay. Now, I know on February 1, that would be tomorrow, you're supposed to meet with the IATF regarding on the decoupling of alert level restrictions, right?
Yes.
Can you explain the concept of that?
Yes, actually, this is part of the direction of the president, where we are able to open up more of our sectors, but of course, not compromising health. Mm-hmm. So when we say we decouple the restrictions, mm-hmm. we have this alert level system. This alert level system that we currently have would have these different restrictions. When you are in alert level 5, everything is closed.
Uh-oh.
When you are in alert level 1, very minimal restrictions. So we would now want to change the mindset of our Filipino people, where you know that there is this alert level system, so you know the risk in your area. Mm-hmm. And local governments should be capacitated to provide safeguards for their constituents. So then restrictions would be removed. It's only the alert level system to stay, just to guide people and just to guide local governments on how they will be responding.
Okay, why do we still need an alert level system in the country?
It's just like the typhoon signals. We need to have people be informed of what's happening across the country in terms of COVID-19. And this is the only way that we can be able to inform them day-to-day what alert level system. It means that if you are an alert level 1, it's low risk, and therefore you can do your thing, but you still need to protect yourself. But if you are in alert level 5, you have to listen to government. You cannot go out of your homes.
Okay, but I'm curious, since we are trying to revive the economy, you have classes are face-to-face now. Let's say it's alert level 2. What would that exactly mean for our daily lives?
Well, if it's alert level 2, there are just some sectors that are not allowed to open.
Uh-oh.
Like, for example,
so may shutdown pa rin?
Not really, because we have already removed or veered away from these lockdowns, even with this alert level system. So there would just be these capacity restrictions. But in alert level 2, the capacity restriction is very minimal, and there are just some sectors that cannot open, like yung mga sabong and all.
Oo. So it's not like before. Hindi the standard of the height of COVID where you'd have a lot of industries shutting down because of a certain alert level.
No, we've long been, we've long veered away from this kind of lockdowns. Mm. I think that was after the Delta experience in 2021, we started revising this already.
So President Marcos Jr. still hasn't extended or decided on, is that correct, the state of calamity when it comes to COVID. Kailangan pa po ba nun?
Well, actually, technical lang ang kailangan natin. Pero kung pag-uusapan natin yung mga kaso sa bansa, I think everything is manageable at this point. Kaya lang po, dun sa batas kasi, nakatali most of what we do for the response dito sa state of calamity.
Mm-mm. So should the, in other words, should the president decide on it soon, does it affect future responses?
Oh, well, katulad nga po, no, he was very hesitant in one of his media outings. So what we did was to do something, some parallel work. So right now, we are doing parallel work so that we can also address the gap brought about by this limitation. So pwede naman.
But will it make a difference if the president extends a state of calamity considering the state we're in today?
Oh, well, the difference would be that we can have emergency procurement for our vaccines. We will have indemnity fund for our vaccination for those suffering from adverse events. And of course, the third one would be that yun pong ating purchase for the other commodities also, mas mapapabilis.
So dahil lang sa pagdeklara or pag-extend ng state of calamity, mag-iiba ito. Is this the problem that you're having now, challenges with procuring the bivalent vaccine?
Well, that's really not a problem, actually. Okay. It's something like it's going to delay the procurement. Mm-hmm. But we are now having these donations, and COVAX facility already has committed to us. And hopefully, by the end of March, we're going to receive the COVAX vaccines already. But of course, we would still like to procure. And if we go through our RA9184, we go through that already. Mm-hmm. We should start now so that eventually, in about 4 months, we will have the vaccines.
Okay. Now, I know the president's concern coming into the new year with a mindset that there's still a state of calamity. Is there another way, let's say an executive order, but with a Bayanihan law, that was a difference.
Yes.
The conditions were quite different. That would make you have an easier time for procurement and have all the indemnity funds, everything you need to function the same.
Yes, that's the reason why we specifically requested that the CDC bill would be certified as urgent.
Yeah.
Because within this Center for Disease Control bill, we have included all of these considerations already without the link to that state of calamity.
Uh-huh.
So if that would be enacted, and then we don't have any issues anymore.
Okay. Now, that was part of the president's State of the Nation address.
Yes.
But is it moving in Congress? Okay.
So it has already passed the third reading in Congress, and now it's going to be discussed in the Senate. So hopefully within this first quarter of the year, it's going to be enacted.
Okay. All right. So before we move on from the topic of COVID, what subvariants are most prevalent in the country today?
Well, right now, the subvariant BA.5 is still the most prevalent if we count because of the cumulative way of adding things. But right now, we are seeing that there is this BA.2.75, which is predominant also. And the XBBs, the subvariants XBBs, meron, pero hindi ganun ka-significant ang number.
Okay. So sa Pilipinas po ba, meron tayong pinangangambahan na posibleng pumasok na variant? Because we often worry what's happening in China, considering, well, of course, it was first detected in Wuhan, but then you did have China acting fast with their own vaccines. What's happening there, and can it come here?
Well, their variant that has been identified would be the BAF.7, and it is already here.
It's already
here. That's why when people were pushing for DOH to close the borders, the government to close the borders, we were saying, what's the use? The variant is here already, and it did not cause any spike in the number of cases.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, what we are trying to be cautious about would be the XBB.1.5, which is circulating in the U.S. or also in other countries, 51 countries already.
Mm-hmm.
But U.S. right now, they are having this increase in the number of cases and hospital admissions because of this variant.
So number one, closing the borders is not an option today.
No.
Not today. Mm. Not anymore. How do you explain the U.S. phenomenon, considering you have the best vaccines coming from the United States, you have well-funded hospitals? Bakit ganun po?
Well, as we always say, no, it's not just one component for the response that will work. Oh. It has to be holistic. So even though you have the best vaccines in the world, you have a agile system, a robust healthcare system, but if the behavior of your people, they are not complying or practicing these minimum public health standards, and then all will go down to that place where you have increase in the number of cases. So that's what's happening in U.S. right now. Because a lot of people are having this behavior where COVID is non-existent anymore.
Yeah, I'm curious. So let's remind our viewers right now the state of mask wearing in the Philippines. Clearly, it's not mandatory, but you do have other countries where, in, for example, Spain, it's not mandatory, but you need to wear a mask inside a train and inside a taxi or an Uber or a cab, whatever you want to call it. So those are two. Sa atin po, saan pa ba mandatory? Maliban sa ospital, wag na yun kasama.
Yeah, dito sa atin, lahat ay hindi mandatory. Uh-huh. So it's both indoors and outdoors that you have the option if you like to wear the mask or not. Pero nakalagay po dun sa aming resolution sa IATF and even in the executive order that you are strongly encouraged kapag ikaw ay matanda, if you have comorbidities, if you know that pupunta ka dun sa lugar na high risk, like maraming tao, you opt to wear the mask.
Okay. I want to ask you right now, Secretary, do you believe that mask wearing should be made mandatory in trains and in cabs?
Yes.
Today, yes. You would recommend that?
Yes, because of this circulating variants in the other countries. But of course, ma-manage naman natin. We are able to balance it off eh.
Kasi pero masikip sa LRT at MRT.
Opo, pero pag nakita nyo ang mga Pilipino, kahit na sabihin natin na voluntary, sinusuot ang mask. So yun
sila
po yung maganda sa atin.
Mismo.
Tayo mismo, meron na tayong ganung behavior.
All right.